When the English arrived at Jamestown in 1607, Atlantic sturgeon had been in the James River for over 120 million years, when dinosaurs still roamed the earth. In just 400 years, there were so few sturgeon left that they were placed on the endangered species list in 2012. Most scientists thought there were too few now to make it. Somehow, though, they survived. This is their story. Once the English settlers discovered Atlantic sturgeon in the James River, they tried to find a way to sell the fish in Europe, but it proved to be too difficult to transport. It wasn't until the 1800s that watermen found a way to catch and harvest female sturgeon for their eggs, which they called caviar. Fishermen came from all over the world for this rare delicacy. Because caviar is black, it was called the Black Gold Rush. By 1920, there were so few sturgeon left, people thought they were gone from the James River for good. Today, people pay about $2,000 for a pound of caviar. Things began to get better after the Clean Water Act of 1972 and a total ban on all sturgeon fishing starting in 1974. The problem was that there were only a few sturgeon left and they take a long time to grow up. Baby sturgeon live their first 2 years in the freshwater part of the James River. Once they're old enough, they migrate from the freshwater James to the Atlantic Ocean, where they continue to grow. After many years, they return to the very same spot on the James River to lay eggs. Sturgeon migration happens every spring and fall. One of the very first people to discover sturgeon again in the James River was Dr. Matt Balazic with Virginia Commonwealth University.
So, hello, my name is Matt Balazic. I'm a researcher here at the VCU Rice River Center with my expertise is in Atlantic sturgeon. They're an anadromous fish that actually spend most of their time out in the ocean and come up to freshwater to spawn. So here's the James River and this is a freshwater area. So the adults will be leaving the ocean and coming up past here to spawn. Any day now that the water temperatures are getting right. Atlantic sturgeon are actually what's considered a relict bony fish. They're very old. They actually are before the dinosaurs, and they have armor plates on their outside called scutes. So this is actually solid bone with like little sharp blades on them. So they're very tough fish, very kind of difficult to work with. They get very large. Adults have been historically measured at upwards of 15, 16 feet long. Most of the ones we deal with are between 5.5 and 8 feet. So, you know, that's up here to roughly about right here, and weigh anything from 80 pounds to a few hundred pounds. And when bony fish started to evolve, most of them went right, and Atlantic sturgeon went left, and they actually have a bunch of really weird characteristics. They have, like I said, we have these scutes, which actually they don't have normal scales like a fish. They actually have bone on their outside. They have ampullae and Lorenzini, like sharks, those little jelly masts on their snout, but they're not sharks. Everyone thinks they're sharks, but they're not sharks. So for us to get an idea of the population size and what they're doing, we actually will catch the fish in gill nets and tag them, put little itty bitty, we call them rice tags. It's something we can inject under their skin, and then when we catch them again, we can scan them and it gives us a number. But something else that we do is we can actually put telemetry tags inside of them. We can knock them out using anesthesia. We'll do a quick surgery. We'll put a tag inside of them that can last 10 years long. Is more like a smart tag, like on your car. And when you're driving around, we put these tolls out there, little receivers, and when the fish swim by it, it'll let us know swims by it, so we can get an idea of how when the fish come into the river, when the salinity is right, how far they go up, which is based on salinity, and when they leave, when the adults leave and they go back to the ocean, we can track how they move along the entire ocean. Along their range. A lot of people really don't work with these fish, we think, because they are very big, they're very strong, they're covered in sharp plates that, I mean, will cut you up. Back in 2012, right around the corner here, we were dealing with some very strong adults, and I was reaching over to grab one and pick it in, and it came back and slapped me in the back, and I had shirts on and everything, and actually left a bruise of its tail in my back that actually lasted for about a week. Sturgeon actually let us know that they were here. We really weren't looking for them much, and then it was actually right up there. One day we were just running on the boat, and out of nowhere, this was in September, just saw a missile come out of the water and hit the ground, and we were just like, that's crazy. Oh, I'm sorry, it was actually that direction, right there at front of Berkeley Plantation, because we actually ran out of gas in our boat. And we saw this big fish, like 5.5 feet, jump out of the water, good 5-6 feet out of the water, and hit, and it crashed. And we're just like, that was crazy. Why they jump, no one knows. They jump when they're this big. It's just harder to see them because they only come like maybe a couple inches out of the water, and you really don't see this fish. But a 7-foot fish can jump 7-8 feet out of the water. Some great photos of them.
From late August through October, there are some great public places on the James River to view sturgeon jumping high out of the water. One place is Hopewell City Point. Another good viewing location is Osborne Landing. If you see a sturgeon, make sure to report it on the James River Sturgeon page on Facebook. To learn more about sturgeon in the James River, there's a great article in the March-April 2021 issue Virginia Wildlife Magazine. We still have a lot to learn about the Atlantic sturgeon, a living fossil that almost became extinct, but now may have a chance.